Hey guys, it's Allie. Welcome to another Time Travel Tuesday, where we combine tingles and nostalgia, as decided by you. So for this week's Time Travel Tuesday topic, I asked you guys to tell me your favorite nostalgic musical artist or band, and the results were very interesting. So here are the top five. At number five, we had a tie, actually, between Pink Floyd and Michael Jackson. Pretty much complete tie. At number four, Spice Girls. At number three was Queen. Number two, The Beatles. And number one was Nirvana. So, in honor of Nirvana, and particularly Kurt Cobain, I wore my best flannel shirt for the occasion and my grungiest eye makeup. Side note, for those of you who were wondering what I looked like 95% of high school, this is it. Except back then I had a slightly less firm grasp on makeup application. Anyway, so to share with you today, I have this really cool box set book that has a lot of great information on the band and its history, and it has a lot of really cool photos and illustrations, and it also includes a lot of kind of memorabilia items like ticket stubs and concert posters and things like that. Not the originals, of course, they're mock-ups. So I'm gonna show this to you in a minute. I'm gonna open it up and show it to you and kind of check out everything that's inside. And I think you guys are gonna like this book. It's really cool. So I'm gonna do that here in a second and tell you everything that I know about Nirvana. But before that, I want to talk about next week's Time Travel Tuesday. I'm going to do something a little bit special for this one. What I want you guys to tell me for the voting is your favorite childhood, keyword here is childhood, ASMR triggers. So what I mean by that is kind of try and recall some of your earliest memories of having your ASMR triggers or triggered, and tell me about that experience. So was it getting your ears checked at school? Was it when your friends like draw pictures on your back? Getting your scalp checked for lice by your mom, things like that. Yeah, my only rule is that it has to be a sort of a childhood memory for you, because we all have triggers now, but I want this to be a nostalgic experience, of course. That's the criteria for Time Travel Tuesday. So yeah, tell me your favorite childhood ASMR memories. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a roleplay of that memory, whichever one is the most common, and try and recreate that experience. So next week's Time Travel Tuesday will be a roleplay. Awesome. So that's it for that. I'm going to switch my shot now. Open up my Nirvana book, and I'm going to tell you everything that I know about this iconic band. Okay guys, here is my Nirvana book. It's called Treasures of Nirvana. got a lot of really interesting things in it that I'm looking forward to sharing with you, while I also tell you some cool facts about the band. Here on the cover we have the legendary bassist Chris Novoselic and the drummer Dave Grohl. This book was written and created by Jillian G. Garr. It says, "Experience the biggest rock band of the 90s with this amazing box set, which includes a fully illustrated color book and facsimiles of rare memorabilia." So I'm gonna open it up real quick. And just pulls out of this little another photo of the band. There's Kurt, Chris, and is it Dave? Dave, I believe. Let me double check that that's Dave Grohl. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is. They went through a lot of different drummers, so kind of had to make sure. I'm not gonna read you much out of this book. I'm just gonna kind of tell you, just like I usually do, some facts that I know about the band, but I think there's a section in here that I will read a little excerpt from. Nirvana was an American rock band that was formed by Kurt Cobain, who did vocals and guitar and pretty much all of the songwriting, and Chris Novoselic, who played bass. And Nirvana was formed, these two young men, in a town called Aberdeen, Washington, in the year 1987. And Kurt and Chris knew each other in high school, but I don't think they really hung out much. They just were acquainted. Or maybe towards the end. I'm not perfectly clear on the timeline, but they both spent a lot of time hanging around the practice space of a band in their town called the Melvins. They both just kind of hung around and hung out with the band. And that's how they became friends. And Kurt created a demo tape of his own music and kept trying to push it on Chris because he wanted to form a band with Chris. And it took Chris several months of Kurt bugging him about it for him to actually listen to the demo tape and decide that he wanted to play some music with Kurt. But he finally did, and the rest is sort of history. They needed drummers, of course, and they went through a lot of drummers, several drummers, which the release of their first album, they discovered Dave Grohl, and he became the most well-known and longest-running drummer for Nirvana. And he is what sort of ultimately gave the band the sound that they were looking for. Now, Nirvana only had 3 studio albums. Some compilation albums and other stuff like that were released here and there. But as far as studio albums go, studio albums with the band, only 3 were created. The first was Bleach, and this was before Dave. First was Bleach, and it was released in 1989. The second was Nevermind, which had Dave Grohl, and was at that point their most successful album. This is what kind of Nevermind was kind of. Nevermind came out in 1991. And then their third and final studio album was In Utero in 1993. So Nirvana had a pretty short run as a band. They were around for 7 years and sort of disbanded in 1994. The untimely death of Kurt Cobain, which was allegedly a suicide. Now, before I go on, I do want to say that the story of Nirvana is not a happy tale. In particular, the story of Kurt Cobain. And I know that that can perhaps not be conducive to tingles, so I'm not going to focus very heavily on Kurt Cobain's death. It is a widely debated topic. I'm not going to explore that in this video. I prefer to focus on the interesting things that I know about his life and the band. So, just to give you a heads up, I won't be focusing on the darker aspects. That there is a lot of positive stuff, but there are a few rays of sunshine here and there. So I prefer not to talk too much about the sad stuff. But suffice it to say that the story of Kurt Cobain is, in my opinion, a very his death was quite a loss for this world. So moving on. I want to read you a section of the book now, so I can open it up. There's a little insert here in the front cover. Here's a photo of them again. There's Kurt and Dave and Chris. And in here is, what is it? It's a tour poster. It says tour poster for Nirvana's breakthrough series of concerts in the UK in 1989. I won't unfold the entire thing because it's big, but it's got the cover of Nevermind. So this is cool. Here's a little table of contents here. And milestones and things. Personal history of each band member. But there's a particular part that I want to read. I'll show you this first. This is a cool little... I'm not sure what you'd call this, an insert maybe. It's got a few cool things in it. Oh, this is... something on the back here. Let me read it to you. It says, "You are cordially invited. Nirvana acoustic concert. Thursday, October 24th. Time to be announced. Come as you are. Off the record 3. 298-4755. I guess that's a phone number. 3865 Fifth Avenue, San Diego, 92103. And it looks like a little signature of some kind, so. What is this? I'm sure it'll tell me. Let's see. Oh, I see. This is item 8, an invite to see the band perform acoustically in store at San Diego's Off the Record. I guess that's a record store. So that's pretty cool. So that was in there. Ticket from Nirvana's Rock City concert with Captain America, 1991. It says, Tuesday, 3rd of December, 1991. Doors open 8 p.m. Nirvana plus Captain America. Support, 9 p.m. Band, 10 p.m. Tickets, $6.50 in advance. Must be 18 years and over. Proof of age may be required. Yeah, cool. There's a few more things in here that I need. Oops. Let's see. This is... this is a rare ticket from a concert in Belfast, Northern Ireland's Connor Hall. Let's see. It says Nirvana. Venue, Connor Hall. Date, Monday, December 9th. Admission, $5.50. one is a flyer from one of the band's first UK concerts, sharing the bill with Tad. It's a little concert flyer. Oh, this one's great. This is a handwritten set list from 1993. This is Kurt Cobain's handwriting. Here's a list of all the songs that they were gonna play in this particular set, I guess. Musical festival of 1991. Cool. That's a lot of neat things just in that one. See, there's some really good pictures. But I'm looking for one part in particular. Okay, I'm gonna turn this around so I can read it to you. This was before the inclusion of Dave Grohl in the band. So this is the story of how they discovered Dave Grohl. So in San Francisco, Kurt Cobain and Chris Novoselic were... I think they were on tour. I'm not sure. Okay, I'll just read. Cobain and Novoselic had gone to see Washington, D.C.-based hardcore band Scream play at the I-Beam, later commenting to Buzz Osborne how great they thought the drummer was. They'd also seen the band play a few weeks earlier in Olympia. The drummer was Dave Grohl, a versatile musician from the Washington, D.C. area. Musically, he'd followed the same pop, hard rock, punk rock trajectory Cobain and Novoselic had, and Scream was his third band. But Cobain and Novoselic had seen the band when it was on its last legs. Scream was on a final U.S. tour that fell apart soon after the San Francisco show, leaving Grohl at loose ends in L.A. He phoned Osborne, whom he'd known for some years, and told him of his predicament. Osborne suggested he phone Nirvana, which he did, only to be told the group had engaged Peters as their new drummer. That is in reference to... what's his name? Peters. I'm trying to remember that drummer's first name. Dan Peters, that's right. Okay. Only to be told the group had engaged Peters as their new drummer. But only hours later, Novoselic phoned back and invited Grohl up to Washington to audition. Perhaps Cobain and Novoselic were feeling some buyer's remorse. On September 22nd, they played a big show in Seattle with Peters on drums that was well received. And the next day, all three musicians posed for photos for a Nirvana piece in the UK weekly Sounds. But what Peters didn't know was that Grohl, who was then staying at Novoselic's house in Tacoma, had also been rehearsing with Nirvana, and they decided to make him their drummer. So that is the story of how Dave Grohl came to be the drummer for Nirvana. Let me go back a page. This is the little spread they have dedicated to Dave Grohl. I am a really big fan of Dave Grohl's. I love Foo Fighters, first of all, but I also think he's just a really interesting person, and he seems like a really good guy. I like him a lot. Once Kurt Cobain and Chris Novoselic auditioned him, they said that they knew within 2 minutes of hearing him play that he was the right man for them. And don't quote me on this, but I think I remember hearing in maybe an interview or something saying that he felt that Dave Grohl was the best drummer since John Bonham, who was the drummer for Led Zeppelin. That's very high praise. So, let's talk about Courtney Love. Was in the band Hole, and she and Kurt Cobain met at a nightclub, I believe, or maybe a concert. And let me try and find a picture. She had a crush on Kurt Cobain. She liked him a lot, so she kind of pursued him, but he wasn't really having it. Not because he didn't like her back, but because... oh, there she is. He wanted to be single. Wanted to be a bachelor, but eventually they started dating and bonded quite a bit through the use of drugs and had a stormy relationship. And in 1992, Nirvana performed on SNL, on Saturday Night Live. And soon after that, Courtney Love found out that she was pregnant. And their daughter, Frances Bean Cobain, was born that same year. And Frances Bean, who is now about 21, I think, was named for the guitarist Frances McKee, and she's the guitarist for a band called the Vaselines. And the name Bean, apparently they chose that as her middle name because when they looked at the sonogram when Courtney was pregnant, she looked like a bean. If you've ever seen a sonogram before, you'll know that all babies look like that in a sonogram picture, not just this one. But I guess they felt it was a fitting middle name. I don't know. Now, when these two got married, Courtney Love wore a dress that was an antique, and it belonged to the late Francis Farmer, Frances Farmer was a film actress and a stage actress in the 1930s, I believe. She was very well known for being frequently admitted to mental hospitals against her will. She had a lot of struggles with possible mental illness. She was just very well known for that. So, Courtney Love wore a dress that belonged to her. And I think they were both interested in Frances Farmer's life, because Kurt Cobain also wrote a song entitled "Frances Farmer Will Have Her Revenge on Seattle." So, moving on. Designed by a man called Larry L. Brooks, who I believe specialized in designing left-handed guitars. And he designed it, and Kurt Cobain played it, and it's now known as the Fender Jack Stang. Short for Jaguar Mustang. I believe Kurt Cobain's was baby blue. Growing up, or when he was growing up, Kurt Cobain had an imaginary friend named Boda. Spelled B-O-D-D-A-H, I think. And in his suicide note, he actually addressed the note to Boda, which I think is kind of sweet and very sad. Spirit Antiperspirant by Lady Stick. Nirvana. So this is kind of like it's meant to look like the Teen Spirit deodorant, which I will tell you about now. The song smells like Teen Spirit. The title for that is an interesting story how that came about. there was a time when Kurt Cobain was dating Toby Vail, who I believe, I'm not sure if she was the singer or the guitarist. Anyway, she was in the band Bikini Kill. Her name's Toby Vail, and Kurt Cobain dated her for a time, and he and Kathleen Hanna, who was also in the band Bikini Kill, was a friend of Toby's. They were having a discussion. I think they may have gotten into an argument of some kind. And maybe not. I'm not sure. But one morning, I think this is how the story goes. One morning, Kurt Cobain woke up to find that Kathleen Hanna had spray painted on his wall, "Kurt Cobain smells like Teen Spirit." Now, Teen Spirit is a brand of women's deodorant, and it was the brand that Toby Vail wore. And she was joking that Kurt Cobain smelled like Toby Vail, I guess. But he woke up and he saw that on his wall, and he loved the sound of it. He didn't really get the joke at first. Thought it was some kind of revolutionary statement. Because they used to talk a lot about politics and anarchy and things like that. And so he loved it, so he wrote the song Smells Like Teen Spirit based on that. Now this is... It says, a rare, unused ticket to see Nirvana play the, I can't read that, oh, the Bosnian Rape Victims Benefit Concert of 1993. Oh, interesting. It was for Friday, April 9th, 1993 at 7 p.m. Section GA, row GEN. Maybe this is just, oh, it's just general admission. That's what I'm reading. It just says general admission. The price was $19.50. Can you imagine paying $19.50 to go see Nirvana? Wow, I can't. There's a few more things in here. Oh, this is great. Is a photograph by Karen Blair, who I think was friends with them. This is a really good photo. There's Kurt, Chris, Dave. Here's another photograph of them, also by Karen Blair. I like this one. This is, what does it say? It says, some amusing advertising for Nevermind. This piece originates from Australia, where the band endured huge popularity. It says, oh. Says Album Network, enter Nirvana. And the dollar bill comes up and you see the baby. So speaking of that album cover, Nevermind. As many of you know, it doesn't look quite like this. It features this photograph of a little baby underwater. And it looks like he's sort of reaching for dollar bill on a fish hook. And it's an interesting, kind of funny story. I was inspired. Apparently, Dave Grohl and Kurt Cobain were watching, just sitting around watching a documentary about water births. For that as the album cover. And they wanted to use some stock photography that they, I guess, had found for the album cover, but the company who owned it wanted $7,500 a year for the photo. So they found someone to take the photo for them. And the photographer, I believe, had a friend who had a little baby, and so they took the photo of the baby. And this baby, the baby in the photo, his name is Spencer Eldon. And apparently, I don't know if this is currently true or not, apparently he has a platinum copy of the album. Never mind. Hanging over his bed. Again, I don't know if that's still true. That might have been old trivia, but he did it one time. Now, Geffen Music did not want to use this picture because of the little baby penis that shows. They thought it might offend some people. And Kurt Cobain was willing to compromise on this, but his only compromise was either we use the photo or we put a little sticker right here over the area that says, if you're offended by this, you must be a closet pedophile. And that was the only compromise he was willing to make on the cover. So, it was either the sticker or the picture. I think that's a funny story. Now this, lucky Nirvana fan club members received letters like this in December 1993. The concert took place on a pier in the harbor in downtown Seattle. So I'll read you the letter. It says, Dear Blank, it's time to change your name. You have been chosen from among about a billion Nirvana fans in the Seattle area to attend the MTV Nirvana New Year's Eve taping on December 13th, 1993, 5 p.m. The taping will be held at Pier 48, Port of Seattle, located at 101 Alaska Way South in beautiful Seattle, Washington. This is no joke. Here's the scoop. You must arrive at the pier promptly at 4 p.m. But before you do anything, you must RSVP 201-420-8223 by December 12, 1993. There will be no admittance after 5 p.m. and you must bring this letter. Congratulations and enjoy the show. Love, the Nirvana fan club. Gold Mountain Management, MTV, and Nirvana. So, this was sort of like a golden ticket item. And probably very exciting if you received one of these in the mail. So, some of you may be familiar with the Weird Al Yankovic parody cover of Smells Like Teen Spirit. When Nirvana was approached by Weird Al asking if he could parody the song, Kurt Cobain was thrilled. He was so excited and so happy because he felt that having one of their songs parodied meant that they had made it, they had arrived as a band. And he also really loved Weird Al. He thought that Weird Al was a musical genius. And if you haven't heard the song, the parody song, Smells Like Nirvana, you should check it out because it's hilarious. The video is really funny. So Kurt Cobain had kind of a troubled childhood, which I won't get into too much, but his parents divorced and he was kind of passed around from home to home for many years during his childhood and his adolescence, but one family member was very, very kind to him and influenced him a lot, and that was his aunt. I believe her name was Mary. She really cared for him in a way that his parents kind of couldn't or didn't. And she was a musician herself, and she really encouraged him musically. I believe she taught him a little bit of guitar and piano, and she was always taking videos of him when he was a little kid. She was just a really good, positive influence on his life. There's a song by a band called Killing Joke. The song is titled 80s. And the sort of opening riff of that song sounds almost identical to the opening of Come As You Are. Now, Killing Joke did their song. When they heard the Nirvana song, it was so similar that they filed a lawsuit. And it's really interesting. I definitely encourage you to get on YouTube and look up the song 80s by Killing Joke if you've never heard it, and you'll be astounded at the similarity. Kind of just sounds like a sped-up version of Come As You Are. Or I should say that Come As You Are sounds like a slowed-down version of 80s. But anyway, they filed a lawsuit about it, which they dropped after Kurt Cobain's death. But the most interesting thing about this controversy and this feud, couple of years before either of these songs came out, The Damned released a song called Life Goes On that features, again, almost the exact same riff. So it could be argued that Killing Joke actually ripped theirs off from The Damned, and then Nirvana ripped it off from Killing Joke. So I recommend that you listen to 80s by Killing Joke, Life Goes On by The Damned, and then Come As You Are by Nirvana, and tell me if you hear the similarities, because I think you will. It's really interesting stuff. He was very, very seemingly preoccupied with body parts, human anatomy, and also with pictures of fetuses. Just really, really interesting. And you can tell from a lot of their kind of album artwork. Videos and things that his obsession or interest in those things really came through, and his artwork is very, very, very interesting. So I do recommend, if you've never seen any, doing a quick Google search of Kurt Cobain's artwork. Really fascinating. So yeah, like on the cover of what was it, In Utero. Let me see if I can find a picture of it in here. Oh well, this is kind of it, but you can't really see it. Let me try and find an actual. It's pretty tiny. You probably can't see it very well, but that angel, picture of the angel, that's the cover of In Utero, and if you look really closely, that angel has a lot of visible organs and bones and muscles and things. It's really, really cool artwork. I like that cover the best, I think. Nirvana was about to play a show at the New Music Seminar in New York. Kurt Cobain accidentally overdosed on heroin that night. Or that day. Courtney Love was there. She realized that he had OD'd. And she injected him with some Narcan. Punched him in the heart. She punched him really hard in the chest. And that night, Kurt performed as planned. I think that's an amazing story. He could have died. But he still went on to play a show. It's amazing. Kurt Cobain suffered from really, really terrible stomach pains. And no doctor was ever really able to diagnose him with anything. They were never really able to explain his pain. And that extreme pain that he was experiencing, supposedly one of the reasons that he abused heroin. So it was one of the only things that could alleviate some of his pain. And this plagued him through most of his life, and he dealt with it up until he died. In 1992, Nirvana was set to perform at the MTV Video Music Awards, the VMAs. Now they wanted to play their song, they wanted to open with Rape Me, but MTV was really kind of discouraging them from playing. For obvious reasons. And I guess wanted them to open with Lithium instead. Or perhaps I just wanted them to open with a different song and keep that one off the set list entirely. But when they came on stage, the very first thing that happened was they started playing a few bars of the song Rape Me, and then immediately stopped and went right into Lithium. But yeah, it was just a kind of a little like F you to MTV. Apologize for any loud noises that you might be hearing in the background. I think the neighbor kids are out playing in the parking lot, so I'm sorry about that. Kurt Cobain sometimes liked to check into hotels Simon Ritchie instead of under his name. And I think sometimes he and Courtney Love would check in under Mr. and Mrs. Simon Ritchie. And Simon Ritchie is the real name of Sid Vicious of the Sex Pistols. And it's a funny sort of reference to Sid and Nancy overtones that the Cobains had going on in their relationship. So it's kind of funny because they were compared to Sid and Nancy a lot in the media, and so it kind of shows that they sort of had a little sense of humor about that. One of Kurt Cobain's favorite foods was apparently Kraft mac and cheese. And I don't blame him because that stuff is delicious. And he and Courtney went to a fancy restaurant one time. And I think that the restaurant wanted to, they knew that he loved Kraft mac and cheese and they wanted to sort of recreate that for him. I'm not sure what they were going for, but it had, I think, pepper jack cheese in it and jalapenos in the macaroni. And it wasn't Kraft macaroni, it was just the restaurant's mac and cheese dish with those things in it. And when it came out, Courtney Love threw a gigantic tantrum about it and threw it on the floor. A really big scene. Nirvana's first single was called Love Buzz. And Kurt Cobain took a copy of it to a college radio station. Agreed to play it, and apparently for most of the remainder of that day he sat in his car and listened to his car radio waiting for the song to come on. And when he didn't hear it, I guess quickly enough, he drove to a and called the radio station and requested the song himself. There's a song by the band REM Let Me In. And that song is about Kurt Cobain. Michael Stipe of R.E.M. was very close with Kurt Cobain, and he is actually the godfather of Kurt Cobain's daughter, Frances Bean, who I told you about. And Frances Bean's godmother is Drew Barrymore, the actress. Here's one of my favorite Nirvana facts. In the town of Aberdeen in Washington, where the band was formed, and where Kurt and Chris grew up, there is a welcome sign as you're driving into the town. Let me find a picture of it here. Here it is. And it says, "Welcome to Aberdeen. Come as you are." And this is just kind of beautiful little homage to Nirvana and to Kurt. And I think it's really sweet. And something interesting happened just this year, actually. In Aberdeen, there were some reports that the sign was going to be replaced because it was getting old, but the replacement sign would not have the "come as you are" part below it. The report said that that was going to be taken out. The mayor of Aberdeen received more than 300 emails from fans begging him not to do it. So, that was, I believe, in June of this year. And now, whenever they update the sign, erect a new one, the lower portion says, "Come as you are," will still be there. As of fairly recently, I think, in the last few years, Frances Bean Cobain, instead of Courtney Love, now has the rights to Kurt Cobain's name, likeness, and appearance. And if I'm not mistaken, the music of Nirvana is also not in Courtney Love's control. And I think that that's a happy note. Well, guys, I sincerely hope that you have enjoyed this week's Time Travel Tuesday, and that you found it interesting and relaxing, of course. And that you learned some interesting new things about Nirvana, because I certainly did. Don't don't forget to cast your votes in the comments below for next week's Time Travel Tuesday. And remember that I'm looking for your favorite childhood memory of early ASMR tingles. And also don't forget that next week's Time Travel Tuesday will be a roleplay recreating those childhood tingles. I will be seeing you guys again very soon. But until then, sweet dreams, time travelers. I'm gonna pour the hot water over the tea. And fill it all the way up.